Hello friends, welcome to the official YouTube page of Everest IAS Academy. So today we are going to discuss February 4, 2020 Hindu newspaper analysis from the UPSC prelims 2020 point of view. So before going into the video friends, I just want to say we have missed the February 2, that is the budget special analysis in the Hindu newspaper that we will be covering in this coming week itself in three parts, that is part 1, part 2 and part 3, because that is considered to be very important for this year preliminary examination. So we wanted to give maximum focus on that particular day, so we will segregate into three series and we will discuss all the issues very in depth. And one more thing is that since our videos we are actually making it little late, from this week we will try to come little earlier, actually at least from after 3-4 days we will be coming very regularly and in very earlier also. So thank you friends, kindly subscribe to our channel and refer your friends also. So let's go into today's video. So the first article which came in the headlines is Supreme Court to frame issues for 9-judge bench hearing religious rights. So basically this is an article which is coming in the backdrop of Sabarimala issue. So we already know that what happened in the case of Sabarimala case, when there was a case which was challenged in the Supreme Court initially, there were actually two aspects which were considered by the Supreme Court at that point of time. One is that the particular petition which was already challenged was they wanted even the woman of menstrual age, they wanted an entry into the Sabarimala temple. So that was actually an issue of right to equality. That is, equality should be given, whatever equality we are which are experienced by men should be assessed by women also. Under that criteria it was challenged. But from the temple's perspective, what they have said is that it is a right to freedom of religion. Under the constitution itself, we have the right to freedom of religion, under which every religion, they can administer their own institution and they can manage their religious affairs. So that is also a constitutional right. When this has been challenged in the Supreme Court initially, what the Supreme Court has given the judgment is that right to equality enjoys a superior position when we compare to this right to freedom of religion. And we have actually, Supreme Court has opened the temples of the gate, gate has been opened especially for women of menstrual age to enter the temple. And this is the situation now. After that, what happened? A review petition has again been, petition has been filed in the Supreme Court. And during that time, what happened? The Supreme Court, instead of looking only into this particular, especially this Sabarimala issue, it has instead said that we will discuss in all the religions the discriminatory practices which are there, and we will actually try to include all these issues under one criteria and we will discuss and deliver a judgment. That is, they wanted to see what is the essential practices of each religion. So why this they have actually went for is that because Supreme Court was of opinion, still in case of Muslim religion, women are not allowed to enter the mosque, and in case of Parsis especially, the woman, if she is marrying an interfaith, apart from another religion, if she is going and marrying, means she will not be allowed to enter the, especially the Parsis fire temple. So these are such kind of discriminatory practices are there in across the religion, and those are considered to be very essential practices according to each and every religion. So the Supreme Court, what it has decided is that at that point of time, so it said that we will consider all these cases under one criteria. But at that time, now what is a recent update is that a senior advocate, his name is Fali Narman, he has actually in his argument, what he has said to the Chief Justice of India is that particular case in which the Supreme Court has went for a wider consideration of wider review has been done by the Supreme Court, instead of actually focusing upon the point in which only the essential practices of Hindu religion was only challenged. So instead, our Supreme Court has unwantedly went for a wider review. That was the opinion of Fali Narman. And this particular objection point has also been now acknowledged by the Chief Justice of India, who said that we will actually consider these issues also while delivering the judgment. So they will try to see whether the point in which they have gone for this wider review, is it permissible and is it allowed or not, that will also be considered, and then they will go and deliver the judgment now. But as of now, the update is that this particular question, in which Chief Justice has actually referred a series of issues, so that has been actually referred to a nine judges. So this 9-bench judge, it consists of senior most judges of Supreme Court only, they will sit and discuss what are the issues in which they wanted to actually, like, they will frame the issues, what they will be considering for this particular hearing, and then only they will consider and delivering the judgment. So that's a recent update, friends, with respect to this particular article of Sabarimala temple. Next article is, we will not spurge to end slowdown. So we know already what is the term slowdown. Slowdown refers to the reduction in growth rate of the country at a time in which India has a growth rate of up to 6.5, and it has, according to the recent second quarterly reports, so that comes in a once in 3 months in a year. According to that report, India is having a growth rate of 4.5%. Even the IMF and even our recent economic survey also said that India will achieve a growth rate of 5% during the year of 2019 to 20. So next year we are actually, like, according to the recent budget, our government is planning to achieve a targeted growth rate of 6 to 6.5%, which is considered to be an unfound optimism according to various experts in the country. So as part of that, the finance minister was questioned that why the government has not relaxed that fiscal deficit target during this budgetary presentation. So, because fiscal deficit refers to a concept in which the total expenditure will actually exceed the total amount of revenue a government is getting during a time period. So, it will consider even the total, like, it is not just a budgetary deficit in which the expenditure will, they will be actually spending more than the revenue, rather, and in budgetary deficit, we will consider only for that year budget only, during that financial year. But in case of fiscal deficit, we will actually consider the total, what are the, especially like deficits, whatever loans which the government has been paying, that all will be considered as part of fiscal deficit. And for maintaining the fiscal deficit, already we have a Fiscal Responsibility Budgetary Management Act. So according to that, had the feasible level of that fiscal deficit the country should maintain is that only 3%. But we have actually we have breached the criteria during the time period from 2008 to 2009, in which our country faced a serious recession, not only India, but it originated in US and it had an effect upon the Indian economy also. That time we have actually went for this, we have included a provision under the FRBM Act where we have gone for a relaxation of fiscal deficit, and it was actually extended up to 6.7% of GDP. So that was the time period in which actually after that, what happened according to the various economic analysis, so during that time when the government went and spent too much money, especially for through MNREG scheme and various consumption boosting mechanisms, that time what happened is that we had a growth actually. So the growth was maintained, but immediately, like, within 2 years our growth started again decreasing. So that was actually the recent statement which has been made by our finance minister. So what she has said is that, see, in our budget, we don't want to take the risk again, so that our laterally, like after 2-3 years, again the same pattern will be repeated in Indian economy. Instead, what the government has decided is that we are actually went for a tax saving mechanism. So by tax saving, most of the middle class peoples in the Indian economy, they will be having the tax saving mechanism according to the recently formed budget. So the excess money what they are having in their hands, that can be actually used for boosting the consumption. That's the government perspective. So instead of focusing upon the borrowing and spending from the government's perspective, we made the people to save the money in the process of tax paying mechanism. That's the government perspective which we have taken in this year budget. In addition, what the government is saying, whatever budgetary allocation we have done, we have actually focused that money to create only public assets. So these public assets will actually boost the connectivity, and in turn it will promote the employment as well as the growth and GDP of the country. So next article is, swarms of locusts spotted in border villages of Punjab. So basically, friends, we have to understand what do you mean by locust. So locust actually belongs to a horned family of grasshopper family only, but it will consist of a short horn. So if this is actually the animal, means it will have a horn like feature. So this actually belongs to the category of grasshopper only, but there are some differences between locust and grasshopper, because these locusts always have a habit of gregarious formation. And a gregarious formation, what we mean is that this kind of actually grasshopper family of locust will always, like, they will assemble in groups, and they will be always abundant, and they will actually try to change their geographical location when their population is abundant, and they will actually go and raid the agricultural fields, and in turn that will destroy the agricultural fields because they will go for gregarious eating. So they will vigorously attack the agricultural fields and they will raid the agricultural fields. So it causes a huge loss to the farmers. But in case of grasshopper, what happens is that they will actually, their numbers are considered to be low, and they don't have the habit of assembling in collective. So that's the basic difference. And even this grasshopper normally will not have any threat to agriculture. So this is the basic difference you have to first understand between locust and grasshopper. Now the swarm of locust means these are the like version of locust, a group of locust. So especially from the grasshopper family only, and that has a actually a short horn like feature. These are also considered to be migratory. They have the highest level of migratory habits, because once their population starts increasing, they will shift their geographical area from one place to another place. That's why they have the high migratory habit, and they will raid the especially the agricultural fields. And this recent locust attack, they have originated from Pakistan. So from the Pakistan, these locust birds actually, they came and attacked the Indian agricultural fields, especially in the Punjab and Haryana region. For that, our government has went for two measures. One is the conventional way, that was only recently followed. We have sprayed the insecticides and we have controlled the population. But there is one more measure which the government can do, is the biological control. In case of biological control, we will actually use a predator. So this predator will be introduced in the agricultural fields, which go and attack these grasshoppers. So this is considered to be much healthier, because these insecticides can have health effects on the farmers as well as upon the farming fields, especially crops. So next article is most missing woman from Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh. This is based upon recently published data from National Crime Records Bureau. We have to understand the basics of National Crime Records Bureau, friends. So first we will discuss that. So this is an official, it is a government agency only, and they will collect and analyze the crime data which are happening across the country. And this crime data they will analyze based upon Indian Penal Code and other laws which are in the country. So this NCRB belongs to the domain of Ministry of Home Affairs only, and its headquarters is located in New Delhi, and this has been formed during the time period of Rajiv Gandhi government time period, that is during 1986. And as we have discussed, they will try to analyze and they will maintain a criminal database especially. So this can be database can be assessed by the various police stations across the country when they are going for investigation. So what they are saying is that according to the recent, based upon the Supreme Court judgment only in 2019, that was like last year, Supreme Court has given a judgment and it has directed this NCRB to just go and analyze the missing persons across the country. So why they wanted to collect this information is they wanted to know how much amount of women and children are actually being trafficked into like especially sexually related offenses. So now what happens is that now according to the data which has been published by this NCRB, based upon their analysis, they found that highest number of women and children also they were found missing in three main parts of the Indian states, that is Maharashtra, West Bengal and Madhya Pradesh. So the indirect logic is that these are the places which are as of now they are facing highest amount of trafficking in the country. Next article is, if tap water meets BS norms, that is Bureau of Indian Standard norms, reverse osmosis system will be banned. Friends, before going into this article, we should understand the difference between osmosis and then reverse osmosis. So basically, osmosis is a process which happens in the normal vegetations of trees. So in trees, we have like particular root like feature. Now what happens is that these roots will absorb the water for its growth and survival. So this water particles which are absorbed, it goes by the rise of capillary action. So it moves from low pressure area to the high pressure area. This is the concept which works in case of plants, and that's how the vegetations are surviving. That is the concept of osmosis. But in case of reverse osmosis, water will be moved from high pressure area to low pressure area. This is the difference, and this is the principle we are using in actually water purification, especially water filters in the homes which we are currently using. So now what is the recent issue means, basically this Delhi Jal Board, so that is the water supplying board in case of Delhi Union Territory. So what it has said is that, what it has actually claimed is that the water which it is supplying is already meeting the BAS norms. So we have to understand what is the BAS norms. Currently the BAS norms, that is the Bureau of Indian Standard Regulation for tap water in the country, and that water which is considered to be drinking purposes, potable water, is up to 500 milligram to 1200 milligram liter of total dissolved solids. If they are found, then that is considered to be an acceptable water criteria for drinking water purposes. So now based upon this, what happened, the Supreme Court actually has delivered a judgment. So especially before the Supreme Court, this judgment has been given by National Green Tribunal. So this is a separate body, so which delivers especially environmental related judgments cases. This body, what it has said is that it has actually prohibited the use of reverse osmosis, these filters especially, in areas where the tapped water piped supply which the households are getting, if they are having below 500 milligram per liter, those are considered to be much safer water. So there is no need to go for any reverse osmosis purifier in those cases. So what is the logic means? Because these reverse osmosis filters are actually creating one problem now, because they are unnecessarily going and purifying and removing all the essential salts also in the process of purifying, and they are depriving the drinking water of essential salts. So this is the based upon the reason judgment. Now like the reverse osmosis concept, how it works is that we will have a semi-permeable membrane. This is semi-permeable means which will allow the water in through its porous surfaces only in a little bit amount, not fully. So it will filter the water. So when salt water is poured under high pressure, when it is pumped through this filter, the contaminants will be filtered in the semi-permeable round, and fresh water will be which will be used in the households. So this is a concept, friends. Editorial article is the camel in the tent. So basically they are discussing about the recent proposal which the government has proposed in the union budget. So what the government has actually proposed is that we are actually planning to attach the medical colleges across the country with district hospitals in the name of public-private partnership. So for that, there are two issues which are discussed in this particular article. First issue, our government is very much concerned about the low amount of doctors in the country, especially because doctor per patient count is very less in India. So we wanted to give quality medical professionals so that when the district hospitals are connected to medical, especially colleges, students can come on internship, and they will actually, this will in turn increase the doctor patient count. But in the name of increasing the better access to health services, we will be actually destabilizing the access to affordable health services, because when we bring in the private sector, means what happens in the public-private partnership, basically especially government hospitals, they function on the logic of especially public welfare, but these private hospitals are motivated by profits. So these two ideologies will come in conflict. In turn, private interest will demand that they will actually enjoy a much more higher criteria in this case of public-private partnership. That's what actually has been discussed in this article. Instead, what this particular Hindu author has actually recommended to the government is that we should actually go and create better health expenditure, because currently our government is only spending under 2% of GDP only for research, especially for health welfare, and that should be promoted. So that will actually in turn promote affordable healthcare in the country. So next article is towards cooperative federalism. So basically, friends, we know this National Register of Citizens, that is the National Population Register our government is going to collect. Here they will collect the resident status, status of the country, the person who are residing in an area for the past 6 months and intends to reside for the next 6 months. Those data will be collected. Here both Indians and foreigners data will be collected. But there has been serious allegations our government is indirectly doing NRC exercise also, because whatever data which they have been collecting and the nature of questions which has been asked this year, many persons across the country are afraid our government is doing NRC exercise indirectly, because if the government is doing NRC, then the government can identify who are the citizens of the country and who are the illegal migrants. So this will actually also categorize the citizens into genuine citizens and those who are doubtful citizens. So this will that's why many states, for example 11 states legislature have passed a resolution against the Citizenship Amendment Act. So that's what I actually discussed in this article. But what this article has also actually given a warning means, because in the constitution there is every obligation for the state under article 355, there is an obligation for states to follow the direction of the union, and if they don't oblige to their direction, means a president's rule can be declared in the state. So this is a constitutional provision. But if you see, friends, in the state of USA there are various laws like anti-gun law and then immigration, anti-immigration policies, in which states have seriously opposed the center's move, union's move. There actually the nature of federalism which they enjoy is totally different in case of India, because now India, what happens is that we follow the principle of cooperative federalism. So cooperative federalism means here nations and states both will actually, they will share the power, but what happens is that whatever decisions which they are taking, their decision has to be taken jointly rather than exclusively. So using this concept, if the government is considering, means they should try to actually consider the opposition which they get through the state's perspective also, in which our government is currently failing to do. So by using the US model as an inspiration, our government should also give some autonomy to the especially states, because where they feel genuinely the constitutional principles are violated. So that's the concept which has been discussed in this article. Next article is Operation Vanilla brings island closer. Basically, friends, in the state of, like in the country of Madagascar, they have been vastly affected by cyclones and flood related features in this year only. For that, our Indian government has sent a flood relief mission. So that has been named as Operation Vanilla. So what happened is that we have sent as a humanitarian mission through our INS Airavat, this submarine, we have actually sent food, clothing, medicines and essential water also. So we have actually helped them during the crisis time. So as part of that, what they are doing is that our Madagascar's defense ministry is going to visit India soon as part of a trip. So India is considering Madagascar as an area which is considered under the Indian Ocean region. So in Africa, actually recently, three different places has been included in this Sagar policy, especially that is Sagar refers to security and growth of all. So this is a policy, security futures and growth related policy, which are actually focused upon like islands in the Indo-Pacific region, especially Indian Ocean region. We have included many island countries under our radar and we are giving some humanitarian measures to them and we are also providing security futures to them. So under that we have included Madagascar, Comoros and then Reunion Islands recently. So these islands are also called as Vanilla Islands. That's why the flood related humanitarian measure which the government has done, it has been named as Operation Vanilla, friends. Thank you, friends. Kindly subscribe to our channel. If you have any doubts, please post your doubts in the comment section.